Hello everyone. I hope all of you are keeping well amid this pandemic. I pray for a speedy and healthy recovery to all the people affected with this disease. Today, we are here for second talk in Coherence Lecture Series by Professor Jyotsna Komaragiri, who is a pioneer in experimental high energy physics. I welcome you all on behalf of Team Decoherence in today's talk. In this lecture series, we will hear from renowned physicists who are actively involved in research in particular areas of physics so that everyone gets introduced to the concept in these fields and how the research is being done in these fields and research methodologies. Professor Jyotsna Komaragiri is currently an assistant professor and an experimental high energy physicist in Center for High Energy Physics at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. She did her PhD from TIFR Bombay. Her research done in collaboration with Fermilab USA in the area of high energy physics. She has an experience of working at three high energy physics worldwide collaborative experiments, namely compact muon solenoid, also known as CMS, a toroidal LHC apparatus, also known as ATLAS, both situated at CERN, and D0 at Fermilab for her PhD. Professor Jyotsna is also a group leader of IISCCMS Experimental High Energy Physics Group, which was formed recently in 2016. She is a co-author of over 850 experimental high energy physics publications in peer-reviewed journals. These are few of many works that have been accomplished by her in the field, and by no means the list is complete. Apart from her scientific pursuit, Professor Jyotsna is also interested in yoga, meditation, and spirituality. Her thoughts on that are, the way we probe matter deeper at CERN, Fermilab, and so on, we probe deeper into ourselves through meditation, which is very enlightening and inspiring. Today's talk is going to be about how we probe matter deeper and search for particles at CMS, at LHC, and also introduce basics of particle physics. Before we start, I would urge all of you to use the Q&A box in Microsoft Teams Live for asking questions, and also on YouTube if you have any questions. Questions will be picked up by the moderators at the end. Without further ado, I request Professor Jyotsna Komaragiri to take over.
Thanks a lot, Rishi, for a wonderful introduction about me and my interests also. I'm really glad that Praviga and specifically Rishi has contacted me, and I was, as soon as the offer was given to give the talk, I was like really happy to reach out to you. Okay. So like today I'll be speaking about, if you have any questions, you can feel free to like put it in the chat box, and I guess then someone will ask me, the moderator will ask. So if you have any questions, please feel free to put it. Before I start, I just wanted to mention that. Yeah, so like I work in the, as Rishik already mentioned, I work in the field of experimental particle physics, so experimental energy physics. And I'll briefly introduce about like what exactly we do and what we do in our field, and give you an overview of how a particle is kind of discovered. Okay, so the main aim of our particle physics is like we would like to search for the fundamental building blocks of the universe, and we have the Large Hadron Collider, like the collider experiments at hand to do that. And we call this experimental high energy physics, also is known as particle physics. Why do we need to do particle physics? Particle physics is basically a modern name to find, it's like really a centuries old aim to find the laws of nature. Okay, so what are the laws of nature? We aim to in this particle physics, elementary particle physics, or the high energy physics. Why we call it the high energy, you'll get to know in the coming slides. So the main aim is to answer two questions in our field. Okay, first is like, what are the fundamental constituents, elementary constituents? Like, can we just, if you are looking at some something in our hand, can we just like dissect it slowly, dissect it to get to the fundamental building blocks? That's the main aim. So we would like to. Okay, so I am getting a bad network quality. I hope you are able to hear me well.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then I'll continue. Yeah, so the main aim is to like find the fundamental building blocks of the matter So whatever world we see around us, we would like to dissect it and come to like one fundamental, one or like few fundamental building blocks which make up the entire universe which we see around us. And not just the building blocks, right? Like these building blocks are put together to form the universe which we see around us. So the forces of forces which control these fundamental building blocks are the most basic, also interesting for us to understand. These are the basic questions which we would like to answer in the field which we work which. And so experimentally, how do we do it? So what we do is we accelerate the particles and we make them interact, and then make them interact at the, at certain points. Like I'm going to show more details about it. And we look at the resulting products and look at the features. And the aim is like once we have some collision happen and once we see the resulting particles and we look at the energy direction and also identify these particles as precisely as possible. And then we kind of do some kind of reverse engineering to find out which particle is produced and whether this is like predicted by this model or not. So those are the things. Okay, those are the things which we aim to do it experimentally. And to answer these questions, we need big accelerators, powerful machines, which are capable of accelerating the particles to extremely high energies and also bring them into these collision points, okay, collision with other particles. So whether it's like fixed target experiment, fixed target means like you have some target and you have a collide, you accelerate the particle beam and then make it collide at this target. So that's like, that's not interesting for us, like only the nuclear physics people do it. What we do is like we accelerate two beams of particles and then make them collide and study the study what happens after the collision at these collision points. So the accelerators are needed to accelerate these beams of particles at high energies. So but like after you collide, you need somewhere to like kind of take a picture or camera or a detector. So since these accelerators are really at high energies, so the detectors are the cameras, which we call them, need to be really gigantic, and these gigantic detectors record the particles as they stream out. Like once the collision happens, whatever particles stream out, these detectors kind of take the pictures or like record these interesting events. And apart from the detectors, we also need like huge computers because we collect lots and lots of data. The amount of data which we cover, kind of collect, is going to be mentioned in the upcoming slides. And we collect the data and also we need to distribute it and analyze this vast amount of data. So we at CERN, we have this grid computing system, and that's what we make use of it to do the analysis of the huge amount of data which we collect. And apart from all these three, we also need people because like we collect huge amounts of data. So we only have worldwide collaboration with expertise in different areas, okay? So we need thousands of scientists and engineers, technicians, support staff, who can design and build and operate such a complex accelerators as well as the detectors, okay? Computing also we need. So the physicists conceptualize the ideas, but like engineers come into picture and then make the thing, what should I say, work, okay? So the accelerator or the detectors, what we call, is like is an engineering marvel. Of course, the physics input goes in, but engineers have a greater role to play in there and make sure the things work. So these four are needed to answer the two questions, the fundamental questions which I have told, like what are the building blocks and what are the forces which bind those building blocks, fundamental building blocks. So if you kind of look at our visible universe, which is billion meters long. So in that, if we look at a galaxy cluster, that's 100k billion meters long. In there, we have the Milky Way to the system which we live in, and then the Earth, at least around 1,200,000 kilometers. And if you just look at the footprint of the sand, and if you look at the sand grain to the silicon molecule, which is like 1 nanometer. So if we kind of look at oxygen nucleus in there, so we look at the quark. So this is kind of, we want to understand the macro universe in terms of these fundamental building blocks. Okay. So Going to the next slide, what is everything made up of? I guess like majority of you know that the atoms are considered to be the fundamental building blocks before we could probe deeper in. But when we Rutherford did an experiment and found that like, okay, there is an electron which is revolving around the nucleus, and the nucleus is also like, is not like just one entity, but it also has some structure. So nucleus contains protons and neutrons. So if you kind of look at the size of the atoms, if the size of atom is one, the part like the nucleus is around 1/10^4 of it, and then the proton, and then the quark is around 10^-8 compared to the size of the atom. That's like really, really tiny. And the electrons which are revolving around okay, so if we consider it in 10^-10 as the size of the atom in meters, then the electrons are of the size of 10^-18 meters. Okay, so this is what we have at the moment. Like, we have the quarks, which are the fundamental building blocks as of now, and the electrons which are revolving around these nucleus make up the atom. Okay, so there are like still some more theories whether the electron is still the fundamental one and the quark is still the fundamental building block. That is like yet to know. There are composite models which say that like probably there are even there is a structure inside these electrons and the quarks, but like experimentally we have kind of proven anything. So we, as of now, we have the quarks as the fundamental building blocks and the electrons as the ones which roam around the nucleus. So while we have the quest to like understand the, go deeper into the structure of the atom or go deeper in the length scale, we found very, very lots of, even though the fundamental ones are few, but we discovered lots of particles on the way. And one more thing I would like to mention here is for the particle physics or the high energy physics, what we are trying to do is, I guess majority of you know that like there was a big bang, and then like after the universe which you live in right now over here, it's around 14 million years old. Okay, so particle physics experiments, like we try to probe few moments after the big bang. So we are trying to recreate the conditions which happened just after the big bang, after the inflation or so. So if you look at the same thing as a temperature versus the time after the big bang, so what we get to see is like these fundamental building blocks, quarks, like quarks, you cannot see them free even at the colliders. So these are produced, which are in the free state at these collisions. And if you kind of look at the time after the big bang, it's around 10^-15 seconds after the big bang, and the temperature we are probing is around 10^-20 Kelvin. Okay, so the accelerators give us a handle to go back and probe or the conditions just after the big bang. Because like we see when these particles collide, like just to if you want to relate it to the way I'm saying it, so when these particles collide, so there is like kind of soup of things which happen here, like those particles which are stream of particles which are produced, those kind of mimic the free state which we get to see after the big bang, after 10^-15 second after the big bang. And from the galaxies, like okay, the galaxies the cosmologists look at, and what we are looking at is like if we are going down in the length scale, and we use accelerators to really probe deeper and deeper to go into 10^-20 meters or so. And yeah, so we need to accelerate these particles to high energy. Why do we need high energy is because like we want to look deeper and deeper. So thanks to Deep Rowley, we understand that an energy is proportional, inversely proportional to the size. If we want to go deeper, if the size is like really small, the energy has to be really, really high. And thanks to Einstein, if we want to discover new heavier particles, new particles which are not naturally produced, but which we can produce them artificially, of course, like probably which was already existing, we need to have this energy mass is equal to mc square. So these two are used. Apart from that, in order to probe the condition of the early of conditions which are in the early universe, thanks to Boltzmann, we have this E is equal to kT. So as I told, we probe to 10^-20 Kelvin, which is in the like conditions in the early Big Bang. So we revisit the earlier moments of our ancestral universe to observe the phenomena and particles normally no longer visible or existing in our time. So like we try to recreate, it's like kind of go, having a time machine and going back and trying to recreate that. All this we do in a controlled way. So I just thought like I'll just share the E equal to MC square from Einstein himself. So this is from Twitter. So I'll just play the one minute video.
It followed from the special theory of relativity that mass and energy are both different manifests the same thing, a somewhat unfamiliar conception for the average mind. Furthermore, the equation E is equal mc squared, in which energy is put equal to mass multiplied with the square of the velocity of light, showed that very small amount of mass may be converted into a very large amount of energy, and vice versa. The mass and energy were in fact equivalent, according to the formula mentioned above. This was demonstrated by Kokra and Walton in 1932 experimentally.
And just to add, Cockcroft and Walton got a Nobel Prize in 1951 after they verified MC square. What they have done is they have used, they showed experimentally that the mass can be converted into energy. So this is like really a good achievement. And what we do at our high energy colliders is like we use the reverse, like we make these particles collide and we try to produce new particles. So the we look for different masses, which are a variety of masses which get produced. Okay, just give me a second. I'm constantly getting this bad network quality. I'll just switch to a different network so that I don't keep getting that. Just give me a second. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then I'll continue. Yeah, so what we do in a pictorial way, we smash things together. Okay, if we didn't have the powerful accelerator, you smash two things together. If you're like, if you look at your siblings or so, you you throw things together and there is a detector which takes the pictures. Before the particle accelerator, this used to be the case, but like this camera, the detector acts as a camera and tries to capture whatever happens, like when these collisions happen, when these particles collide. And we use, before I move on, we use something called electron volt. I just want to mention the unit which we use. So what is an electron volt? Electron volt is like, we use this for mass and energy. For us, C equal to one, that's what we use in our calculations. It's to simplify our lives. So one electron volt is like the energy, the kinetic energy gained by an electron when it accelerates from, if it is a potential of one volt, if it gets accelerated between this one volt, so that's what we call as one electron volt. And we also use that to code the energy also, okay? Energy as well as the mass. And in these specific units, in this fancy units which we use, the mass of proton is equivalent to one GeV. G stands for 10 power 9, okay? So MeV is 10 power 6. And TeV is 10 power 12. So 10 power 12 is, we are going to use TeV in the next few slides. So it's good to recall it's 10 power 12 electron volt. And yeah, so apart from fundamental building blocks, we have to look at the universal forces which bind, right? So the I'm sure like you, every one of you know, or even if you don't know, like there are four fundamental forces. So which is the strong force, which is the main thing to have this protons and protons and neutrons bind together. So those form nuclei and also they form hadrons. Hadrons I'm going to talk later. Apart from the strong force, there is something called weak force. If the strong force has a strength of 1, weak force has a strength of 10 power minus 6. And this weak force is responsible for the radioactive decay, neutron decay, beta decay, or other, even the burning of the sun. And I guess every one of us know the electromagnetic thing, because like we have to have the photons to see, right? So the strength compared to the strong force is 10^-2, and this is responsible for the atoms, light, chemistry, or electronics. Apart from this, the gravitational force, everyone knows, if the strength is strong force is 1, the gravitational force is the weakest one, and this is responsible for the solar system, galaxies, and the black holes. And apart from these four forces, you see that like there is something called gluons, photon, WNZ, and graviton. So these particle physics is a kind of quantized, like we use a quantized quantum field theory. So what we say is like for each of these forces, there is a force carrier. Okay, for the force carrier is like the gluon for the strong force, for the photon for the electromagnetic force, WNZ for the weak force. And if we kind of prove that gravity could be quantized, so the carrier of the force is called the graviton. And so this is like this is falling of the object. So the planetary motion is responsible for the gravity, and electromagnetism and electricity is unified to have the electromagnetism, and then the weak force, which is responsible for the nuclear decay or the radioactive decay. So in the standard model, which we see, standard model of particle physics, it's like our kind of Bible or Quran or Gita, so which says that which has this electromagnetic force as well as a weak force unified, and the strong force which binds this nucleus together. These two are put together, and these are part of the standard model, and the standard model is experimentally verified to like highest precision. So coming to the grand unification, the aim was to have unite electroweak force and the strong force together and have the grand unification, but we haven't so far succeeded in doing it. And if you want to put even the grand unified theory and also gravity in the same footing, then we have to go for the theory of everything. But what I'm going to cover in today's talk is mostly like the standard model of particle physics and some aspects of going beyond the standard model of particle physics. And as I told, forces as interaction. So if you kind of consider throwing of a ball by one person and catching the ball by another person, the same thing we can look at for the electron repelling with an electron with an exchange of a photon. And thanks to Feynman, who came up with this wonderful idea of pictorially depicting the electron interaction with an electron through an exchange of photon. So we use this Feynman diagrams, thanks to him, to kind of calculate theoretically all the observables which we can measure experimentally. And the standard model of particle physics is like kind of the chemistry periodic table, right? So something similar to this. So we have leptons, the electron which we know, and these up and down make up the nucleus. So we have three families of leptons and three families of quarks. And only the first generation is the one which we get to see in the visible stable one, and in the visible part of the thing which we get to see. Muons are also there, but like they decay. So the second and third generations are like artificially produced, but like they do exist. They did exist earlier, but those are produced and they decay to the first generation. So these are the three generations of the matter particle. Why three? We do not know. As of now, we only see the three generations. And then the force particles, electromagnetic for the photon, WNZ for the weak force, and the gluon is for the strong force. And then apart from that, like we have, for quite some time, we were looking for this Higgs. And 8 years ago, we found it at LHC. So I'm going to talk briefly about the Higgs particle also, which is responsible for the mass of all these particles. So coming to like, let me introduce the Large Hadron Collider. So why large? Because it's a 27 kilometer circumference ring, and it's the world's largest, most powerful particle accelerator. As of now, we are in the shutdown mode, but it's the most powerful accelerator in the world. Okay, so even though there are other experiments. And this LHC super microscope operated at center of mass energy. Center of mass energy is like if you just have these protons and protons in coming in different directions, but then you have the you can add up this and have this total center of mass energy of the 7 TeV. TeV is 10^12 electron volt. So we collected data from 2010 up to 2018 with varying center of mass energies. And this is a 27 kilometer circumference ring. And this is mostly, majority of it is in France and some part is in Switzerland, in Geneva. And I worked on both ATLAS and CMS. And India is in the CMS compact muon solenoid experiment. So it's a kind of decision by the country to join one experiment. So I'll introduce CMS also in the next slides. So let me just have a few seconds of introduction to the Large Hadron Collider.
The Large Hadron Collider, or LHC. Inside this pipe, two beams of protons are sent hurtling around a nearly 17-mile loop before being smashed together to create subatomic particles.
Okay, so it looks like some Diwali event or the fireworks, but like what happens is like whatever is happening here, so we have huge detectors to collect these debris of interactions. So I'll introduce the detectors in the next coming slide. And if you kind of go back, so probably like around 13.8 billion years ago, there were like some aliens who had this Large Hadron Particle Collider built, and that's how we see the visible universe, which we get to see. And we try to study the physics laws of the first moment after the Big Bang. And large because we have the 27 kilometer circumference ring. This is like the highest one which is running in the world as of now. And hadron, okay, collider because like we accelerate these protons and collide. And what is this hadron? Okay, hadron is a bond state of quarks put together. If you have a bond state with three quarks, it's called baryon. If you have a bond state with one quark and an antiquark, you know that there is an antimatter, right? So for each quark, there is an antiquark, antimatter. So if there are, it's a bond state of those are called the mesons. And I'm saying this hadron collider is a broadband quark and gluon collider. Why am I saying it is a broadband? Okay, quark and gluon, I understand. Quarks, because like there are valence quarks inside the proton, and the gluons, because those are bound together by like these quarks are bound together by the strong force, which are gluons are the force carriers. Why am I calling it as broadband? So even though we are saying we understand that the protons are composite particles, even though I'm saying that like protons are accelerated at like let's say 70 eV of energy each of them to have the center of mass energy of 14 eV. We know that these are composite particles. These are made up of other fundamental building blocks, and let's call them as partons. Okay. So whenever these protons interact, it's not that the entire energy gets converted into like 14 eV of new fundamental particles or new particles are produced. What happens is like since these are composite, so one of the parton from the proton from this proton interacts with the one of the parton, either it could be a quark or a gluon, interacts and then tries to produce a new particle. And the energy carried, because like these partons carry only a fraction of energy of the proton to interact. So it's not exactly like 14 eV of energy gets converted. Only a fraction of energy from these interacting partons are getting used. So it could be like 1 TeV to, let's say, even up to 14 TeV, like, just to give an example. So that's why it's a broadband. Even though it's like we have 14 TeV, we'll not be able to use the entire energy, only fraction of that, which will have a range of energies and range of particles produced will be used at these colliders. Okay, that's why it's called broadband. And these hadron colliders have a long history. So they have WC bosons, which are the weak force carriers, are discovered at CERN, and top quarks is discovered at Fermilab Tevatron, which is in US, and where I worked for my PhD. And on 4th July 2012, so the Higgs-like boson, CERN has announced with a lot of this thing, and even on 2013, the Higgs and the Francis, they got the Nobel Prize. So on 4th of July 2012, Higgs-like boson was discovered at Large Hadron Collider, and at that time, we called it as Higgs-like boson because like we haven't studied the properties in detail. But like after almost a year, less than a year, we studied all the properties of the particle, and then we called it as a Higgs boson. Okay, so one thing before I still have time. So one thing before I move on, so I just want to mention that all the bosons like WC bosons or the Higgs boson have a kind of tendency to be discovered in Europe, and all the quarks, like top quark or the charm quark, have historically has been discovered in US. So we thought, like, while I was working at Fermilab, people thought probably Higgs will be discovered at Fermilab, but a lot of people from Europeans told, no, the bosons have to be discovered at CERN. So fortunately that was the case, and we found the Higgs boson after a long sought search. Okay, so at the moment, okay, we are in the long shutdown mode, and we'll probably restart data taking in 2022, not next year because of the COVID situation. And that's kind of really intro. So let me just give an overview of how we do the data analysis from collision to physics results. So, like, this is a detector, compact muon solenoid detector, and we collide. The protons come in different directions and collide at the center of the detector. And after the collision, you have seen this fireworks in the animation there. So there is a debris of particles produced. From those debris, like those debris are responsible, like some theory is responsible to produce those debris, and we analyze the data, and we see some kind of peak or for a particular mass, and we try to relate whatever we have experimentally seen with the theory. Okay, that's what we do, and I'll try to explain this in detail in the coming up slides. So before I move on, let me just introduce the compact muon solenoid. So this is a giant detector. It's almost like a 14,000 ton three-dimensional camera, which will take pictures with 75 megapixel precision, and we collect and it takes this 40 million photos per second. And if you want to look at the dimension of it, like, these are the people who are standing over here. Of course, like, this is not when the beam is on, when some construction or the renovation or like work is going on with the detector. When there is no beam, then only we can enter the hall. So these are the people in there, and this is the size of the detector. Okay, let me show. So this is the total weight, is like as I mentioned, it's 14,000 ton detector, and overall diameter is around 15 meter, and overall length is around 21 meter, and it's almost like a cylindrical cylindrical onion, where we have the beam pipe followed by a tracker to track the charged particles trajectories, followed by the electromagnetic calorimeter, and then the hadron calorimeter. Then those are put in a solenoidal magnetic field, and then these are put in the muon detector. Okay, so it's like a cylindrical onion. Probably I'll just show it here. And the beam enters in the z direction, and this is the xy plane. Okay, the cross sectional beam is in the xy plane. If I kind of look at only like some segment of it, it's like a cylinder. Okay, so as I told, there is a tracker. This is where the beam is coming in, and in the z direction. And this is the tracker, and then the electromagnetic calorimeter. Calorimeter is to like deposit, collect all the energy from the electromagnetic particles. Okay, the particles which interact through the electromagnetic interaction. And the hadron calorimeter is through the strong interaction, the particles which are produced through the strong interaction. And these are in order to kind of have the trajectory of this charged particle. These are put in the solenoid magnetic field, and the muons have a peculiarity to like go or travel to even an entire detector. So in order to capture those muons, so we have kept the muon detector towards the end. So this is like a typical detector, and it's a kind of, even Atlas will have a similar structure. So once these heavier particles, Higgs or even the W and Z bosons, or even the top, they do not, as soon as they are produced, they decay into the lighter stable one, which are the first generation of particles, which I have shown in my previous slide. So we identify five types of particles, like which I'm going to show in this simple animation. So this is the same thing. And if you kind of look at the muon, muon just traverses through the entire detector, and the magnetic field is slightly different because of the structure of the detector. So that's why the bent is like the trajectory is bent in different direction. And if you look at the electron, since it's charged particle, it leaves a trace in the tracker, and then it deposits all the energy in the electromagnetic calorimeter. I guess you know that it's to kind of capture the energy. And if you look at the charged hadron, it goes through the entire the calorimeter, the tracker, as well as the electromagnetic calorimeter, and deposits the entire energy in the hadron calorimeter. And then if you look at the neutral hadrons, they'll not have any track. Since those are not charged, you'll only see the energy deposition in the hadron calorimeter. And for the photon, it mimics similar to the electron, but it will not have a, since it's not charged, it will not be bent, it will leave its energy in the electromagnetic calorimeter. So these are the traces which we see for different particles, these five stable particles. So we have to use these identification criteria for these particles and do reverse engineering to have to develop an algorithms to find these particles at the different detector sub-detectors, and then using this we try to reconstruct back the original particle which is produced. Okay, so we do something called a reverse engineering to go back to the original particle which is produced. So this is the same thing, but like apart from this, I guess everyone knows about the neutrinos. I haven't introduced it in the earlier, but like for electron, there is an electron neutrino, and similarly for the second and third generation, there are neutrinos. Neutrinos do not interact with the matter at all, so those are weakly interacting particles. So how do we detect them? So what we see is like since the collision is happening in the z direction, and the momentum is the momentum of these protons is only in the z direction, there is no transverse momentum in the xy plane. So we for the initial thing, so initially, so we see if there is any missing transverse energy over there, so that we associate with the neutrino, because there is nothing initially. So if there are particles which are produced which do not match up and give rise to zero, that means there is something which is missing, and that missing could be the neutrino or even the dark matter candidate, which also doesn't interact with the huge detector. Even the 14,000 detector, it doesn't interact, and it will just leave the detector without giving any trace. So the proton-proton collision happens like this, and we have debris of particles, and at LHC we create 1 billion mini Big Bangs every second. Of course, like whenever we are data taking, as of now we are not taking any data, we are only analyzing the data. And just to give a little bit more details, so 70 eV proton beam comes in one direction, and the other one comes in this other direction, and collides at these interacting points, like either it's CMS or ATLAS detector. And we do not have really continuous proton beams which are colliding. So what we have is like we have bunches of protons which are like accelerated and accelerated in bunches, and then those are made to collide at these points wherever there is a detector in place. So the bunch crossing happens at 40 megahertz or so, and in these bunches there are protons. Even in these protons, since these are composite, so only the parton collision happens. After the collision happens, like there are new particles which are produced. So just to give an example, okay, even though the bunch crossing happens at the megahertz rate, like even the collision rate is around almost the gigahertz, our interesting physics happens really, really at a very, very low low frequency. Okay, so if we want to look at event rates, like it's 1 billion per second, but the event selection, our interesting part is like 1 in 10 power 13. Okay, so it depends on the process which you are looking at, whether it's like a standard model Higgs or even like some fancy scalar leptoquark particle. So it depends on the model which you are looking at. So the event selection will, or the probability of occurrence will be really, really low for that. And I guess I can just skip this. So at the collision point, what happens is like this is a proton. So it contains this soup of particles like up quark and down quark, which are bound together through this up down, bound together with the gluons. And the other proton comes in. Since we are accelerating to 70 eV, so the speed of these protons is like almost close to the speed of light. And since those are like really, the electromagnetic interaction doesn't play much role over here. They interact with the strong force, and then they get stretched. Okay, the gluon snap from quark and antiquark pair, and some interesting thing happens there. So either it's a top anti-top pair or like something which gets produced, and finally that decays to Higgs, and the Higgs boson is unstable, so it decays to like one of the decay modes of this is like two Z bosons, and these Z bosons decay to the muons. Okay, so if you want to find the Higgs boson, we have to kind of reconstruct these two muons and reconstruct the Z boson over here and the Z boson over here, and only through these four particles we try to go back and do the reverse engineering to find the particle which is produced the Higgs boson. Okay, so yeah, so that's about the production. So let's look at the data rate, whatever we are accumulating. So the collision rate is around 40 megahertz, and we have something called a trigger system, which is like in the real time, we'll not be able to stream 40 megahertz onto the tape or even the disk and then do the reconstruction or so. So we have to select only, and also, as I told here, let me just go back. It's not interesting to collect all this data, right? Like whatever at this rate, you'd like to only collect the data which is relevant for our to do our physics. So for that, we have something called the trigger system, which is called the online event selection. So we have level one trigger as well as the high level trigger, which I'm going to show briefly in the next coming slide. So from 40 megahertz, what we kind of have on the tape or on the disk is only around the order of 500 hertz or so, even like 1 kilohertz or so. And even after doing this event selection, what we collect is the amount of data is around 50 to 60 petabytes per year. Okay. Yeah, so here I'll explain Atlas and the CMS system. So Atlas has something called the level one trigger system, so which is completely the hardware or the firmware based. You have a firmware is like you have something on the front end, and you have an algorithm developed on the chip, and you only select the interesting event based on that algorithm. If the threshold is passed, then only you will pass it on to the next stage. So Atlas has the level one and level two, and then the event filter, which is completely the computing form, processing forms. So from 40 megahertz, we can have order of 500 hertz or like 100 hertz to be on the recorded on the tape or on the hard disk. Okay, so CMS, what it has is like instead of two levels over here, we only have level one, and then the high level trigger, and the similar thing happens from 40 megahertz. We reduce the rate or the rate of events to collect on the collect to 500 hertz or so. Okay, so probably I can just say this. So level one is the custom hardware plus firmware, so which reduces 40 megahertz to 100 kilohertz. And level two is like computing form, but like level two is the Atlas thing, but CMS uses everything put together, and we call this as a high level trigger. We have a computing form very close to the detector itself, which does this detailed reverse engineering reconstruction, which I have already explained, right? The five particles which we get to see. So depending on the signature in the each sub detector, the particles are reconstructed using this software for computing firms. And just to give an example of what is this level one, level two, and level three. So level one is like a trigger, which is the real time event selection. So let's say we want to select Higgs boson. Okay, so level one we do not have, because it's like really not the granularity is not that great. So level one will not have any course like fine information. So these are the four candidates which we get to see. So we say, okay, probably these are all the four candidates which we will see. So once we kind of have these four candidates, so at level two you have selected this event, and only in that particular region of interest, okay, there is something happening over here, only in the region of interest in this particular angular space you do the reconstruction, improvise it, and say that, okay, these three look like kind of Higgs boson, and this doesn't look like the man at all, like a human being at all, so this could be discarded at the next stage. And at level three, since we have the huge computing form to process, so we'll be able to have a little bit more information. So there we'll be able to discuss. Sorry, I'll go back to my full screen. And we'll be able to discuss other two. Of course, like we'll not be doing the entire. The above person is Feynman and the below is Higgs. We'll not be doing the entire data analysis while we are collecting the data. So we will have some background events also. So we'll have Feynman also in our creeping into our data. Okay, this is an example to say that how the online event selection works. And as I told, we work on this computing grid. Just before I move on to the grid computing, I just want to say that if you are not aware, the World Wide Web, WWW, is invented at CERN, and we last year, of course, it's 31st year, which we celebrate of its anniversary. And the grid infrastructure, what happened, the grid does is like the collision happens at CERN. So we have tier zero, where the raw data, which is coming from the detector, is used, is stored. And we have to process it and do the reverse engineering and reconstruct back the original events, right? So for that, we have something called a tier one system, where the tier ones are all over the world. And then tier two is for the users to do the analysis. So we have this grid computing system and tier two and then the tier three. So these are the simple computing clusters. Of course, like each tier one or tier two has a different capacity to do it. But in order to process this, we have developed like a lot of IT protocols and also the grid computing structure and also authentication specifically for us to do the processing. Okay, this is used to analyze the 50 to 60 petabytes of data which we collect every year. And just to introduce the terminology, like the trigger is whatever happens at online. So data is collected online. But once we collect the data after going through all this level one and the high level trigger or the level two, level three. So once the data is on the disk or at the tier zero, which is already recorded, the physicist will have plenty of time to do the detailed analysis. Physicists like me and also my students. So that's what we call it as offline. And at offline, we'll be able to do the optimization of the selection of events and also model the background and also look for different interesting physics models which we are interested in. So the online is whatever happens at the in the real time, and offline is like the physicists where we work with at leisure majority of the time. And let's look at the offline data analysis. Okay, we have collected the data, but like how exactly we do the analysis to find these Higgs particle or any other fancy particle which is predicted by the theoretical models. So from these debris to this, so what do we do? So we collect data from many channels, from the many sub detectors, and decide to read out everything or throw away the event. So the trigger, which is a real-time event selection or the online selection. And then we build the event, we put all the information together, and then we store the data, and then analyze them through the reconstruction, user analysis algorithm, and also do the data volume reduction. I'm going to provide the details and do the same with the simulation. So these will be covered in the next coming slides. And after we have this, we compare the data, whatever we have analyzed, with the theory which we get to see from get it from the simulation. Okay, so I'll cover this. So just to give an example how we do the data acquisition. So let's say these are the sub detectors, and we have the front end electronics coming over from there, and those are connected to some trigger system. Okay, trigger system is basically whether it has to be passed on to the next stage or yes or no kind of decision. So after this, like if it is yes, then it will go to the high level trigger, the computing firm which I have mentioned earlier. So though there the detailed reconstruction happens, and then once the reconstruction is like good to go, if it is yes, then it will be stored in the data storage, okay, not on the floppy disk, which will not be useful for us. It's only like a pictorial view to see. And given if you look at the rate, so rate is around megahertz to start with from the detector output, and after we do this high level trigger and online deconstruction, so we'll be able to reduce it to almost like 100 hertz or so. And after we have this data stored, so we have to analyze it, right? So in order to analyze, we have to have something called reverse engineering again, based on the sub detector paths, and also we have to calibrate them and also align them. Have the alignment done. So that's what we do. This is called the reconstruction step. And after that, we have, this is called the reconstructed data, which the users can analyze. And then the user analysis program runs over. And from there, we have our fancy physics plot coming out. Okay, so here, from the petabytes, if the data storage is in the petabytes, so we, for further data storage after the reconstruction goes to terabytes, but the user reduces it to kilobytes. So like we do huge amount of data reduction because like we are looking at only one particular physics process of our interest, okay? And let's look at what exactly happens from the detector to the reconstruction. Like I told, we do the algorithm development and do the reverse engineering, right? So let's say we have a detector element and a particle passes through, and this is the front end electronics, which is on top of the this detector. So we collect these analog signals and we do digitize them and do the reconstruction. And then we say that, look, if a particle has passed through this, then it has left some kind of trace, which we call it as hits. Hits, okay, which will have this four coordinates. And if we kind of put it together, we say, since it's a charged particle, we do the track finding and track fitting. And since we have the magnetic field, the particle will bend and we'll have the helix. So we can, from these helix, we'll be able to measure the track momentum, okay? So this information is stored for each and every event and every track. So event will have a number of tracks. So if we kind of look at event one, event two, depending on the number of tracks, we have the different information put together. Even the charge of the track could be known because we have the magnetic field, whether it's bent in this direction or this direction, we'll be able to know the charge of the track also. Okay, so then coming to the simulation workflow, this is for the data. So simulation workflow, because like, okay, the data we have collected, raw data from the detector after the real collision has happened, but we have to compare that with the theory, right? So in order to do that, we have to rely on the simulation. So first thing is, the first step is like we have to have some theory physics simulation, which says that the protons are collided and this particular interesting process is produced. Like let's say here the Z0, which is one of the weak decay force carrier. Okay, so then it has to go through the detector simulation. You cannot say that like this particle is produced, but like in the real data, the protons are colliding, but it is going through the entire detector, right? So these produced particles, the physics of our interest, has to go through the entire detector. So it has to simulate. We have to simulate. We use the GN4 as a main source to do that. So it has to simulate bending of these charged particles in the magnetic field, and they have to leave the energy in the tracking, and also the electromagnetic calorimeter. All this has to be done in the detector simulation. Once the detector simulation is done, we have to reproduce whatever I have shown earlier, the digitization part. So the electronic simulation also has to happen. So electronic simulation also has to happen. And only after these three processes, whatever we get out is equivalent to whatever we have from the real collision event. So the simulation, we have to go through this extra step of producing. And okay, so just to just to note that usually the detector simulation is very CPU intensive. So we usually, if you need some samples, we have to produce them and we have to wait for quite some time to make them available to us. And after the simulation workflow will be same. So after the detector simulation, whatever data storage, whatever we get, and later on the offline analysis follows the same exact steps as the raw data, okay? And probably I can just skip this. Okay, so in the simulation, what we do is we simulate the physics process, just to again give an overview, and then put it through the detector so that the detector response is also understood. And after that, we compare it with the real data. So simulations are not just used once we have the real experiment in place or when we have the real data, but those are used even to, let's say like we are thinking of having a high energy, even the highest energy version of LHC, which is HLLHC or even the FCC. So even though the accelerator or the detector is not conceptualized, but we use the simulations to even give some hints to go beyond whatever we have. Okay, so simulations are used not just for the real data, when we have real data, but also to make new experiments or new design choices. Okay, to summarize, our task is reality is we have a debris of data coming whenever this collision happens, and the theory gives some fancy theoretical model. So as an experimentalist, we intend to fill this gap between the reality and the theory. And the theory, I guess not many of you know, it comes in the Lagrangian form. So it gives various, it will have various parameters, coupling constant and masses. But what we experimentally measure is only like some kind of physics observables, which are the cross sections, the probability of occurrence of that particular process, or the probability of decay of a particle into certain other particles, and then the lifetime. So thanks to Feynman, we'll be able to, like, through this theory, we'll be able to have this physics observables calculated by the theoreticians and given to us. And experiments, okay. In experiments, what we see is only the analog signals. Okay, this is like some kind of a pictorial view of it. And what we have is an address, which is address of that particular detector channel or so, and then the electronic values. So as an experimentalist, we have to use this information and then develop different algorithms and identify this different particles. So like experimentalist job is like really complicated. Okay, so one has to appreciate how much of task which go in to have this fancy particles detector or research at the collider experiments. Okay, it's really an interesting task, interesting and challenging task. Okay, so making the connection. So we have the raw data from the reality. So this is like imperfect measurement of interaction in the detector. And the theory gives some kind of some general equation with some parameters. Of course, like, some are really poorly and not known at all. Theory has to go in hand with the experiment only, and then only they'll be able to go further, okay, and provide some more inputs. And from the raw data, we do the reconstruction of the events, and then we find some fancy event which says that Z boson is decaying to two muons. And the theory gives the physics observables, as I told, the cross sections, the probability of occurrence of that particular process or so, and other parameters. And once we analyze, once we use these reconstructed events and we analyze through our processes, so we confront the theory observables with the whatever we measure experimentally, whatever we measure for this cross section, we confront it with our analysis. And the typical analysis workflow is, okay, this is like on the left side is for the raw data, detector and the trigger give rise to like the events. And then we have this reverse engineering called the reconstruction of various objects. And similarly, for the simulated data, we have to have the physics simulation and then the detector simulation and the electronic simulation put together, and then the reconstruction of these different particles which are produced in this physics process. And these our parts are centrally produced by the collaboration, of course, like where we have to follow up and make sure we have our interesting samples produced. And then the user does the physics analysis. This is carried out by the individuals or the small analysis teams. Once we have this physics analysis, which is like which you have reduced it to 1 kilobytes or so, kilobytes per event or so. So there we compare the theory and experiment, and then come up with whether this particle is observed or not. Okay, so then I move on to some examples of this physics analysis. Let's look at standard model and the discovery of Higgs. So production of Higgs, like the collision has happened and the Higgs boson is produced and some fancy particles are just stable which are produced. And the Higgs boson is like really a giant leap at LHC to find, because this gives the origin of mass, okay, how these particles interact and acquire the masses. If we haven't found the Higgs boson, which was missing piece since 1964, theoreticians predicted that Higgs boson has to exist, but it took almost 50 years or so, 2012, we were able to discover it. Okay, so these particles, how these particles acquire the masses, they interact through this invisible field, which is called Higgs. And through this interaction, depending on the mass of the particle, it could be heavy or low. So the interaction strength will be heavy or small. So they acquire the mass, and the field is called the particle, associated particle which is associated with this field is called the Higgs boson. Okay, and as pictorially depicted here, So this is unstable. So as soon as it is produced, it decays instantly to like various decay modes. Zg to fermion is like one of the decay modes, and we only look at this final state particles, and from then we do the reverse engineering to reconstruct back the Higgs boson. Okay, and if you kind of look at this Z is produced decaying into two muons, 1Z to 2 muons. So if you look at the event, so the muons are further in the detector. Okay, so you see clear signature of these, and once we do the invariant mass, or like once we do the reconstruction of these two muons put together, we'll be able to reconstruct the mass of this. And we have to do this for the other Z boson also, and then reconstruct back and come back to the Higgs boson mass. And in 2012, on 4 July 2012, both the experiments, the ATLAS as well as CMS, showed that we have seen this bump, which is equivalent to over here, okay, yeah, over here, which says that it's the Higgs boson which is produced. And by the way, Fabiola is the ATLAS, she was the ATLAS spokesperson earlier, but now she's the CERN director general. Okay, so both the experiments discovered it, and this is really a giant leap for the science. And this is the CERN auditorium. It was before the for the announcement of this public announcement or so. This hall was filled or occupied from 4 a.m. People were waiting outside. They were just looking for their slots, spots to sit, because like they know that this announcement is going to happen. So from 4 a.m. or so, this hall was like completely packed. Of course, like some seats were reserved for all the people who are in the higher positions. Yeah. So for the first time, Peter and Francis Englert, they met at CERN when this announcement at CERN has happened on 4 July 2012. Even though like that, apart from Englert, there were four more people who predicted this Higgs boson or the Higgs mechanism 50 years ago, but only these two are still alive, so others are no more. So these two got the Nobel Prize in 2013, Englert and Higgs. And so we are looking for this, whenever we are looking for this particle, we call it as a resonance, and we see some kind of peak when we reconstruct the mass of this decay particle. So four leptons, we see the peak over here. And for the two photon decay case, we see a peak. This is the background which we have. We see a peak which is which says that this is the Higgs boson. Okay, these bumps in this data, we call it as like a bump hunting, signify that like there is a new particle, and this is found in two different ways in 2012. And this is the first time we have found an elementary scalar spin zero particle observed in nature. And we can say that the standard model is the remarkably successful theory. Just to give an understanding of that was in 2012, 8 years ago, 1964, it was theorized. And in 2012, we have ATLAS and CMS have discovered it. And these two guys have got the Nobel Prize in 2013. Okay, so this was the data which we collected in 2012. With that, we are able to see like the hints of these bumps over here and over here. And we have collected a lot of data after that, which we call it as run two. Okay, so if you see, the statistics has increased a lot, and we can clearly see in both the experiments the peak of this particle, the Higgs resonance, and also it's clearly evident, and there are no statistical fluctuations, as you can get to see in the previous slide. Okay, so and we have also done a lot more things, and recently we had the international conference at Prague, which is again online. So CERN has announced on 3rd August the first indications of rare Higgs boson decays, and these are some kind of candidate events. So where the Higgs decays to only two muons. Okay, so this is like one of the decay modes where you see a production mode where you see two muons in the forward direction, and the Higgs is produced at the center, and it could be also produced with like some more top and anti-top pair produced, and you see that the Higgs is decaying to two muons. These are really the fancy events, and it can also be produced with like two forward jets and then two muons here. So these are really the candidate events, and for the first time, CMS has seen the evidence of this Higgs 2 mu decay. Okay, yeah. So Yeah, so the first, there was the first evidence, two Higgs two mu mu process with three sigma. And if we look at the particle mass and the Higgs coupling parameter, so we were able to predict these masses for top, W and Z, bottom and tau, lepton. But for the first time, we are able to even do it for the muon, which is the second generation lepton. Okay, so this is like really, really the off the press or the breaking news from the press. And coming to the success of Stanman model. So if you kind of look at on the y axis, I'm showing the order of magnitude 10 power minus 4 cross section in the picoband, 10 power minus 4 to 10 power 5, almost like 10 power 11 order of magnitude. Okay. So here, if you kind of look at various processes produced on the x-axis, you can see that the theory and the experiments are matching pretty well, pretty well. So this is like really the success of the Stanman model. And what is on the y-axis is the probability of occurrence of that particular process. That's what we call as a cross section. Okay, so Stanman model is measured. Okay, each of this analysis is like there are a lot more teams working on it. So this plot takes huge collaborations to put together. Okay. And this is still the Stanman model. Why do we need to go beyond Stanman model? Is Higgs boson mass is unstable, and also the Stanman model doesn't explain a lot of open questions. Okay, I'm going to talk about the open questions in the next coming slide. So first thing is like the Higgs boson mass is unstable, and also there are a lot more open questions which are not answered by the Stanman model. Because of that, there is something called a supersymmetry. What says is like for each of the Stanman model particle, we'll have some super partner. For quarks, we call it as quarks, Higgs bosons, Higgs inos, leptons, leptons. Gauge, for gauge bosons, we call them gauge inos. But like we do not know these masses. We only have seen these visible particles, these supersymmetric particles. We haven't seen. There could be like of the order of 1 TeV. The mass scale could be of the order of 1 TeV or so. So far, we haven't seen. Okay. So apart from this, the supersymmetry predicts something called the dark matter candidate. So which is not encompassed in the Stanman model theory. So that's why we have to go beyond the Stanman model to kind of predict or have some theory to predict the dark matter candidate. And dark matter was, there was an evidence found for the dark matter to be there. If we kind of look at the rotational curves of the one of the galaxies. So if we didn't have the dark matter, it has to go, the rotational curve has to go like this. But what is experimentally observed is like this way. So that means apart from if it is like some kind of a depiction of the collision of bullet cluster. So there has to be like apart from the visible matter, there has to be some dark matter which is somewhere in the in there. It's dark because like even if you impinge a photon or put photon over it, like it's not reflecting it back. So that's why it's called dark. So there's a dark matter which interacts only through the gravitational interaction. So supersymmetry gives a hint to have this dark matter particle inbuilt in the theory. Okay, and that's why supersymmetry, we have to go through the supersymmetry. And apart from the supersymmetry, there are also other different modes to produce this dark matter. So there is something called the indirect detection, direct detection, and then we can also produce them at the particle colliders. Probably I'll just go over it quickly. So in supersymmetry, okay, like we look at some observables. Okay, let's this number of jets or some variable over here. So what we see is whatever data, these are the data points and these are the background models. Okay, so data is very well matching with the backgrounds, and this is a theory which predicts that like if we have this dark matter candidate in there, this dark matter is called chi is over here, we should have seen some data distribution coming over here. Similarly over here, so this is like the data is completely matching with the some of the backgrounds. And this is what the theory predicts. So we haven't seen any events which populate this theoretical thing. So the quest for the dark matter still continues. Okay. And if you kind of look at the universe composition, so we have only like 5% of the universe, which is explained by the Stanman model. And the 23% is the dark matter, which is not yet explained. And the dark energy, at least the colliders do not have any access to have any kind of say about the dark energy. So at least the dark matter, we have some indirect way to measure through supersymmetry or some other particular models. So only 5% we are able to cover through our standard model, but we still have the mystery to resolve of the 95%. And we are at least probing this 23% through our whatever means we have the colliders. So it's a lot of challenges and exciting times are ahead for us with the data what we have and with the data which we are going to collect in 2022. And yeah, so coming to the open question, at least thanks to E equal to mc squared and the Higgs, we are able to find the origin of Mars. That was unfinished business for quite some time. At least that's answered at LHC. And there are still open questions like what the 95% of the universe made of? Okay, so dark energy and dark matter put together. And we don't see much of the antimatter in the universe. So like what is happening to the antimatter, we do not know. And also we do not have any say of what was the matter like within the first second of the universe life. We have this quark-gluon plasma, but like we do not understand that also completely. And also, do we have any unified theory of physics, unifying all the forces into one? And that's still in process. Okay, so there are still a lot more things to be looked for in future. And before I conclude, I just want to say that this is the India CMS collaboration. So CMS has almost I have to update this, there are almost 50 countries right now and close to 300 institutes and more than 5,000 members in there. And this is the India CMS collaboration. And after I joined IISc, I made sure IISc is part of this CMS collaboration, and we are still in the process of getting in into the funding part also. That's still a work in progress. And this is me at the CMS experiment. I visited it in 2019, last year. And you can reach me on my email ID, and you can find more details in my homepage. And thanks. Any questions? Probably I can stop the screen share, right? Yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the talk and explaining us such a complex topic of physics in such an interesting and understandable way. So we have some questions, and I will be saying these to you. First question is, how do we define or measure the size of quarks or electrons?
How do we define the size? So in order to find the size of the nucleus, we had something called the deep inelastic scattering experiment. So it's similar to what Rutherford has done. Okay, nothing complex. So you kind of probe the particle, and looking at the deflection, you try to see whether there is concentration of what is the density concentration over there, right? So in a similar way, we try to find the size of the particle.
How likely is it for us to discover a new particle?
How likely? Well, that depends on what theory says, and whether majority of the time theory gives us some probability of occurrence of that particular process. But apart from that, we have to, as an experimentalist, we spend a lot of time in understanding the normal backgrounds. Only if we have a handle on our backgrounds and understand that, then we go and look at the signal, and that depends on when can we find the other particle, new particle is depends on the probability of occurrence, the probability of that, and the amount of data which we have. Okay, because if we have a lot of data and the production cross section is really tiny, we need a lot of data to analyze. Okay, depends on the probability of occurrence of a particular particle. In a simpler way.
Next is, what temperature is reached in the accelerators? How close is it to the temperature after Big Bang?
Yeah, that I mentioned in my one of the initial slides. It's pretty close, and it's equivalent to 10 power 20 Kelvin or so.
Is it a theoretical result that only these four fundamental forces exist? May there be others?
I guess so far we have seen only these four fundamental forces, and gravitational we experience, and other three are seen. And recently, at least a year ago or so, there was some hint about the fifth force. But okay, so that's like we usually, like when something fancy comes up, we kind of look at it. But I guess later on, depending on it, could be a statistical fluctuation or so. We do not believe in it so much. So there was some prediction to have fifth force, but I don't think that is confirmed yet.
If the universe is made up of quark, made up of up quarks, down quarks, and electron, why there is a need of generation of three types of particles?
Well, the three generations? Three generations probably they do exist to explain the things around us. Okay, muons exist, like muons come from the cosmic rays also. So those do exist, like in real life, but they decay before they come to Earth. Okay, so other generations are like only like three generations which we have seen, and the three generations kind of explain this standard model theory well, and we have experimentally, artificially, after producing this. Other particles which are predicted by this standard model, we kind of came up with the idea that there should be three generations. But we do not have any answer. There could be fourth generation, but probably at the moment we are not able to reach there. Okay, we need not restrict ourselves to the three generations. It's like the model is built over 50, 60 years with the experimental theory going hand in hand.
Next is, could you please elaborate a little on the interaction between quarks, which keep them together?
Yeah, that's the strong force. That's a strong force which the gluons make sure that they are put together. The interacting force is the gluons. And the typical, what should I say, the feature of this strong force is only the, you see that the proton is bond. Okay, proton has this composite particles. So inside this proton, inside this this kind of 10 to the minus 18 meters or so, the femtometer, the quarks are like really in a free state. But like as soon as you try to pull them apart, the strong force feature, they'll not we will not be able to see the free quarks. Again, they'll try to form a bond state. Okay, so that's one feature which we see, and I guess this. Deep inelastic scattering experiment, which was held at HERA, which tried to probe deeper inside this proton, showed this new the feature of the QCD or the strong force.
Next is by Ankan. A new collider is being made even bigger than the LHC. As far as I have heard, I mean he has heard. Does it have the power to recreate situation during the primordial soup?
Primordial soup, I'm not sure, but at least closer to what we have at LHC. So probably we'll go back to this. And the idea is like, okay, there is a linear collider which is planned, which is kind of blessed, and probably it will be built in Japan. Let's see how it works. But like that's only to study the detail the properties of the Higgs boson with lot more precision, and also to study more things. And the other 100 TeV collider or 80 TeV collider, which is going to come up at CERN, hopefully like it requires a lot more funding. It's still in the conceptual design mode. At least it got some blessing. So there, the idea is to kind of the ray process, like the SUSY, which we haven't seen, the supersymmetry, which we haven't seen so far. So the Higgs boson was discovered, like was at least predicted in 1964, right? So there were like series of experiments which at CERN, large electron positron collider, where electrons or positrons were collided and tried to produce this Higgs boson. We haven't found that there, and also at Fermilab in US, and then we came back to CERN. So it takes a while to find these particles. It took almost 50 years. So at the moment, whatever reach we have with the LHC, we are probably not able to go beyond the or reach this higher energy regions. So probably with this future colliders, 100 TeV or so, by then probably I'll retire. But we'll be and probably some of you will be leading this field or so if you join this. So probably there we'll be able to have more hints and say something about the supersymmetry or beyond the standard model. Okay, that's the idea, but let's see how it goes. So from 14 TeV to 100 TeV, you can imagine it's like a really a leap in the energy.
Next question is, can we predict at which point the collision will occur?
We do not predict. We have some kind of spread. Okay, even in the detector, we have a spread in the z direction because, as I told, this is not like a cleaner event. We are doing this composite particles, a proton-proton collision. This is not a electron-positron collider where you can clearly say that, okay, the collision is happening here. So the interacting, there will be like some kind of spread in the z direction. And we take into account that spread in the z direction. It's almost like 25 centimeters or so within the detector. So we, when we do the analysis, we take that spread into account.
How are neutrons or other neutral particles accelerated?
We do not accelerate the neutrons or so. We only accelerate electrons, positrons or protons. Neutrons, we haven't. Of course, like once they are produced, we'll be able to look at the energy deposits and say that it's a neutral particle, but we haven't accelerated the neutral particles. Probably you can provide some useful idea, like who's ever asked the question.
If the top quark also decays, why do we classify it as a fundamental particle?
Okay, top quark also decays, but the top is okay, so it has a peculiar property. Okay, one more thing is the Higgs boson, the top has to be there in picture in order to even have some kind of explain the stability of the universe. Let me not go into a lot more details, but top plays a crucial role in explaining even the Higgs boson mass and the stability of the universe, metastable state or the stability of the universe. If you kind of look at the top mass versus the C boson mass, it gives like some kind of hint to the Higgs mass, and it's like even though it's decays as soon as it's produced and it doesn't even form any bond state, it has to be there in order to explain a lot more things in the theory. That's all I'll say. I'll not go into a lot more details into the theory because it will be too complicated for you to understand.
What other theories are being tested out at CMS and ATLAS, and what more are we hoping to find from these experiments?
Okay, what other theories is, first of all, Stanley model we have already seen. Higgs boson was not known at least like till 2012, so we are trying to provide this a lot more properties, and as of now we are even like one of my students, me and my student are working on Higgs boson is discovered, but like how it couples to itself. Okay, so that's one more interesting thing to work on. So that's what we are working on. And the dark matter, like two of my PhD students are working on this dark matter at colliders. There are like some kind of different signatures specifically for the dark matter production. So we are trying to see with the model which we have in hand, whether we'll be able to say something about the dark matter production at LHC. Okay, so, but apart from this, there is supersymmetry. There are also large extra dimensions, and there is a composite models. As I told, like quarks and electron need not be the fundamental particle. There will be compositeness also, and there are other fancy models. Like in order to explain the dark matter candidate, there are some dark photons or some dark sector, hidden sector, and a lot more things are going on. So there are a lot of models which are there, and we are exploring all of them within our reach.
Next is, as the protons are bunched, is there a possibility for a two-on-one type of collision or any other type of collision between protons instead of one-on-one collisions?
Yeah, so we have we have something called a pileup where the collision from within the bunch also there are extra garbage which is coming in. Of course, we try to look at the hard scattering. Hard scattering means like only when the one-on-one proton collision happens. There is a particular signature in the detector. Only then we kind of detect. But apart from there will be like some kind of background noise coming from other collisions also that we try to discard. So within the same bunches or within the different bunch also, we try to, depending on the, because like each thing will have a different time signature, right? Because like within the bunch, there will be different time signature if it is with a different bunch. It will have some delay, so we use this is called in time or out of time background also. We have means to reduce that and look at only the interesting hard scattering event or interesting event where the proper collision has happened.
what kind of data and plots are studied? What are the factors that help us reconstruct the collision?
Okay, so what kind of things are studied is, we have only this electron muon, the stable particles in there, right? So we'll only deconstruct those in the at the online trigger level or even at the offline. And then we have some kind of calibration for them. Those will be look only like an algorithm based on the different subdetectors. So we have this algorithm, those will be only the candidates. And then we have to refine those algorithms. So we use standard candidates like Z to mu mu to calibrate the muons. Z to Z boson to electron-electron to kind of have an energy calibration for the electron. Then only we say that these candidates are probably the closer to the electron which we see in real life, muon which we see in real life. Only that's how we kind of have this identification criteria in place. And then we use these finely deconstructed objects after our identification put in place and use it to have the physics objects or the physics particle which is predicted by the theory. So that's how we do. And we look at like a lot more complicated kinematics of each of the signal or the background. Hopefully that answered the question.
Next is some part of the analysis also done by layman volunteers as done in large observational astronomy projects.
No, this data, like whatever we have, is like really kind of proprietary. I mean, we have to be part of the collaboration in order to access it. But we do have CMS open data, and which open data is like open to public, which could be used by even anyone. Like majority of my summer students work on the open data and do some simple analysis. Depending on the interest, you can kind of come up with like there was like recently one paper, at least 6 months ago or so, there was a recently one paper with open data and measuring the confirming the Higgs from the data which was released. So, or even like having a different paper from the open data. So for the, it's a proprietary to only the collaboration, but other people can use the CMS open data to like get some hands-on experience of working in this huge collaboration and also working with this huge amount of data.
Next is, how is the signal separated from noise?
How is the signal separated from noise? Okay, yeah, so as I told, if you're talking about the electronic signal, of course we have our different thresholds to make sure we are collecting real good data. But for the analysis point of view, we kind of have some kind of orthogonal region, which is not the signal region. And we use the simulation and the data to model our backgrounds to to whatever best knowledge we have. Okay, so even the background modeling takes, my students are working on this from at least two of them for the dark matter searches from past almost 1.5 to 2 years, just to make sure that we understand the backgrounds well. Only if we have understood the background well, we'll be able to look at the signal region. So it takes a while to have a understanding of the background well, then only we'll be able to look at it. And why it is complicated is because there are a lot of detector effects which we have to model well, and it has to be also modeled in the simulation and also has to match with the data. Okay, so there is a lot of things are convoluted in when we are convoluted into the analysis when we do look at each distribution. So it takes a while to understand the background. Only once we have 100% sure that the background is modeled well, then we open the unblind the data and then look at the signal region. So it takes a while, and it also depends on, we have a lot of data to analyze, petabytes of data, so it takes a while.
Two more questions. One is, can experiments at LHC generate mini black holes?
Yeah. just to go back in history, so a lot of people, even though the probability is like really, really tiny, so there was like a lot of opposition earlier when we were restarting in 2008, Large Hadron Collider, that LHC will produce a black hole and the entire universe will be eaten away. but that's not the case. We are in 2020, we are still there. So there's like tiny probability that that might occur, and there are people who are working on the black hole analysis also. So far there is no hint to having it done.
One more question is, why electron and other particles not have a structure?
Probably they have the structure, but with the microscope or the super microscope, what we have right now, we are not able to probe deeper. That's what I can say. We need probably higher energies to go deeper. So the energy what we have is not sufficient for us to understand the structure of those electron or spark.
So these were all the questions. Thank you, ma'am, for the talk, and I hope that everyone has gained a lot from this. And no, thanks. I request. Yeah,
thanks a request. Lot for organizing such interesting talks. Like I guess yesterday Arindam gave a talk, and it's like really nice to see all the UG students being being so active, and even during this pandemic, you have taken up this challenge and doing it. Like I really appreciate it. Okay, so it's really nice. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to join. Okay.
Oh no, it's our honor to hear from you. And so I request Abhib Shah to conclude with a vote of thanks.
First of all, we would like to thank Professor Jyotsna for taking the time out of her day and giving this extremely fascinating talk. We would like to thank the Dean of the UG program, IISc, for making this talk possible. And we would like to thank Team Pravega for supporting us and for helping us in the organization of this talk. And we'd like to thank the audience for attending, and we hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, do check out the Pravega website, because we have a bunch of other talks coming up. The next one is on Saturday, 11 to 12 in the morning, and it's by Rajas Purna, who will be talking about a super fast PCR technique for COVID testing. And as for coherence lectures, we will be back next month with a bunch of other interesting talks. And so till then, goodbye and take care.
Thanks a lot. Bye.
Thanks, ma'am.